Mr. Dr. Mahesh Babu will be able to talk about these things and maybe a little bit about battery you would like to talk today. Because that is the theme which has started out. So why don't you come up?
One of the toughest things is to talk after a policymaker and a professor. So I'll try my best to do what I can do. Okay. I'm going to just talk about what Mahindra did on EV space. We have been the pioneers of electric vehicle in India for some time and happy to welcome the new entrants in this year. And it's going to be a kind of a scenario, what it is, what we have done, and how we are seeing the important things we need to do as a community to make India an all electric, which is the vision set by the government of India. Let's look at what we have done. Mahindra, we have invested on electric a decade ago, and we are a strong believer in electric, and we have been always saying that all electric is the future, because the electric technology by itself is pretty efficient when compared to a internal combustion engine. And we did a lot of things in last 8 years, I would say. And we have some learning which I thought I will share with you. See, we are the first one to run about 68 million kilometers on Indian roads. So we have cars which are connected, which are electric, and now we have got into the shared mobility space for the last 2 years, and we have some experience around it. So we have about 4,000 plus cars. I was told in India we have about 4,012 cars, out of which 4,000 is Mahindra right now. And we are present in about 18 cities. And initially, our business model started off with use in the personal segment. So we went and sold to people who are environmentally enthusiastic, and we have been trying to convince them to buy. Till 2 years back when we realized that's not going to happen, and it's important that electric vehicles have to be put on fleet space and shared space where it makes sense economically. So professor talked about subsidies, it can't survive. So 2 to 3 years we have been extensively working on deploying electric vehicle in fleet and shared space. And then we realized that electric vehicle, once it is run close to 200 kilometers a day, it makes economic sense. You need not make it subvent, or you cannot be apologetic that it's higher acquisition cost. So we did trials with a company called Lithium in Bangalore, and we converted all employee transport into an electric mobility with a small E2O car, which most of them at that time believed that it will not work. But today I can say that it has run about 20 million kilometers only on those things. About 300 cars are running, and it has run reliably, durably, and many of the cars have covered more than 1.5 million kilometers now. Based on that learning, then we have tied up with almost every single fleet operators, because electric makes sense if you run the car more and more, because you have to utilize the asset well. So we tied up with Ola. We have cars in Zoom. We have also announced a partnership with Uber. And the mega event of EESL 10,000 car tender. I think while there are a policy announced by Government of India led by Niti Aayog on EV mission, I think it has changed the way India looked at EV from 2017, I would say. It makes a completely different sense. Whether it is a social media or any international media, now the discussion is how India is going to meet the challenge of 2030, all electric. The point is, whether we are meeting or not, at least we have set a direction and we have started moving towards it. It helped a lot. And while many of us blame the government of only policy and not taking action, I would say in EV, I will not do so, because immediately after the policy, ESL came up with a 10,000 electric vehicle buying tender, which is the largest in the world. Today, there is no company in the world which has given a tender for buying a 10,000 cars. So that is a welcome move. This set up a confidence in the industry, because industry, we have invested in 2010, and to be frank, till now, we are not making any money on electric vehicles business. But with the hope, that's the future, and we will make one day money, as professor said, when the prices come down. So that is a big change to India, I would say, and that has set up a lot of challenges as well as opportunities for India, both for industry, ecosystem, and the other things. I have already talked about it. There is an EV rollout in India. It started off mainly from the mission set up on National Electric Mobility Mission, then followed by Niti Aayog report on all electric. I would say 2017 is full of talks on EV. While we still struggle to sell cars, there are huge number of talks going on. But the reality is that has set up what we have to do in the future, because the talks is not for that year, it's for the future. And we are happy that the Indian government understood two important critical parameters, the energy security, even the economic security of importing oil. And hence, there is a challenge to set up a mission for India, and that was electric. So after all this rollout, if there are a lot of studies now which has said, I think Anilji has touched upon it, if we become at least 40% of our fleet becomes electric, India will be the largest market between 2030 and 2040. There are debates whether it will happen in 2032, 35, it doesn't matter. The reality is India will have as much cars next to China as Europe and US. And once you have so many demand, then there is a huge potential to have the technology in-house. It has a huge potential to make in India, and it has a huge potential to skill and have the talent base in India. So we'll have to see this as an opportunity, an industry, as an industry. We are looking at this as an opportunity to build up a new industry and also give a clean, green environment for the cities where we live in. But this is going to shift the energy dynamics today. Already, there are a lot of talks about oil and oil companies now talking about energy companies. So they have redefined oil industry into energy industry. And this comes from a fact that our oil import, crude import bills are going up and up, and we can't afford by this stage at 2030 and 2040, because we grow about close to 10% in auto industry. And the prediction is if the GDP grows faster, we will be close to double-digit figures, which will put a lot of pressure on oil imports. Incidentally, India has become energy or power generation positive this year. So this has given us a huge opportunity to think about how to shift from energy which is coming from oil to energy which can be charged at homes. There are a lot of debates about pollution. There are people says EV has lot of, how do you say coal burnt energy will be more efficient than more less polluting than oil based. I will talk about it before going into the next step. According to us, even if you take 10 million EVs in operation, which is predicted to be 2030, 2040, it's going to be just 3.2% of total power generation capacity of India in 2030 and beyond. So there are a lot of debates being asked, where will the power for India come from when we go to EVs? I think it need not come from anywhere, because from where we are generating, we need only 3%. The challenge is it's 3% nationally, but the EVs are going to be present in cities, which is going to have higher percentage of density, and hence how the grid is going to perform becomes the challenge. I'm sure when today we have a pollution problem in cities, we have a solution. I'm sure if we have a grid challenge, some of you or many of you sitting in this room is going to come out with a solution to support electric vehicles in the future. According to our study today, even if with close to renewable install capacity of about 15%, still the CO2 generated by electric car is much lower than, at least 20% lower than the equivalent car which is running in gasoline or diesel. So this is one part which is of global warming, but I would say India has one of the most highly polluted cities. So the issue is where you generate the pollution. If you make EV cars, actually you're not going to generate pollution in the places where people live. It's not about CO2 alone. You have hydrocarbons, you have nitric oxides and other carbon monoxides which you are going to reduce in the place where you live. And hence, while there were debates, we are completely convinced that EVs are, one, shifting the pollution from where we live to a place where it is generated. And over a period of time, with India setting up a solar or renewable energy mission, we are going to improve on CO2 overall, which is going to help in global warming. I will take the Q&A if you don't mind by the end. Yeah, sure. Now, having said that, EVs and what we are doing, we are coming up with many vehicles. This is going to create two different scenarios in India, according to me, which I thought I will share with you. One is the rural context and another is the urban context. Now assume the 10,000 vehicles of 15 kilowatt hour battery is going to be there. You're going to have close to 160 megawatt of energy lying somewhere in the city. So we can use them on two fronts. One is you have to charge them, and another is you can use them if you want. So this in urban context is going to put a different scenario of how to handle the grid when EVs become very popular use in cities, because our prediction is EVs will adapt more in cities faster before it gets into rural. Having said that, we also see that a lot of microgrids getting developed around rural areas. India is setting up some solar lamps, solar things like that. So there is an opportunity we are exploring how the microgrids can help to charge EVs and how in rural areas we can actually they not depend on oil transport to those areas, and how we can become totally dependent solar charged EVs to be used on local transport. So I see this in two different contexts. While there are EV technologies being talked about globally between Europe, US and all that, there is always a question to Mahindra, when are you getting a car like Tesla in India? I think the answer is very simple. If India wants a car like Tesla to be manufactured by Mahindra, you will have it. But the priority is EVs are not one which is to be forced on the customer because of we want it. I think he has to embrace it, or he or she has to embrace it because he or she feels it. And if we can make that, then EVs become popular. And how can we make that? Two front. We have a pollution challenge. We have a congestion challenge. It's important that we educate customers and particularly fleet operators to make sure the EVs are adapted in a very economical way, not just for only environment. It has to make environmental sense, but that is given. You need to make it economic sense for anybody to buy. India is very unique. Why I'm saying is it has large two-wheelers, it has three-wheelers, it has public transport like buses and of course, four-wheelers as well. But always when we talk about EVs, the more focus is given on four-wheelers. What Europe is doing, what US is doing, what Tesla is doing, what others are doing. I think India has a very huge challenge of last mile connectivity. We have recently, government of India have been investing hugely on mass rapid transport like metros. Even we are talking about buses, electric buses. You need a last mile connectivity. So three-wheelers play a vital role in India. If you ask me, the three-wheeler industry is saying that before 2030, the three-wheelers will become all electric because it makes economical sense to run a three-wheeler in a battery form, either in swapping or in charging mode. So while the 2030-32 mission says all electric, there are some segments, according to us, three-wheelers can become all electric. Fleet of four-wheelers economically makes sense to become all electric. Now, if this becomes, what is the challenge on us as citizens, as what is the challenge on infrastructure providers? We need to take care. That's what I'm talking about. So to me, today we have a system of energy distribution by oil. I think it's going to get disrupted. Auto industry is already disrupted. You can see that many of us are now not only attending auto expos, but we are into ISGW forums and IEEA forums and everywhere, anywhere. So there is a dynamic change already happening. And we believe that smart grids and EVs will actually balance the energy demand in India, which can take a load on peak, and it can play a role. We have already done grid-to-vehicle trials with our vehicles. The challenge to us is it's not incentivized today. The grid-to-vehicle, vehicle-to-grid, or vehicle-to-grid bidirectional things are not done because India doesn't have a dynamic charging system. You don't really give peak charges for electricity demand, and we keep installing capacity. So I believe, as an industry, electric can play a vital role in reducing the demand, peak demand of India, and vice versa, if we smartly work together between auto industry, policymakers, academia, and all of you together. What we see way forward? I think the demand is getting generated by government's vision of becoming all electric. The order of EESL and many more tie-ups, what we have done in fleet industry with Ola's, Uber's, Lithium, Bhagirathi's, we are seeing a shoot that the EV adoption has just taken off. We need to do a strong study of potential in infrastructure intervention, because without charging infrastructure, the EV dream cannot become reality. While we say that we don't want to drop any technologies, either charging or swapping, I think it is important that we do a lot of pilots. If you look at our experience in last 8 to 10 years, every pilot we do, we learn a lot. Suddenly there is a, when you put 3 or 4 charging stations of 10 kilowatt together, there is a huge demand on the grid, and locally we have some disturbance. So while there are global players who want to bring a 100 kilowatt charger to charge in 30 minutes, it's viable, but it's going to put a lot of challenge to us. We have to get prepared for it, because if you put a 100 kilowatt charger, it needs a separate supply of grid. And today, India needs to get prepared for such things in the future. We also need to optimize the technology to make it sustainable to key stakeholders, because right now, industry, either it is auto industry or supply industry, is not prepared and not making money on it, and hence it has to be self-sufficient to make it viable. And we are looking at how the grid and power producers and grid players are going to play a vital role. To us, we'll have to work together to make the grid smart, which balances the demand and supply, and EVs can play a vital role in it. So my key message, I would say, is EVs are disrupted already in auto industry. Unlike North American industry, in India, one of the auto industry themselves have disrupted, which is Mahindra. So no outsider have come and disrupted us, and we are happy that we now, Tata's and others, are getting into EVs as an auto industry, are embracing to the change. And this will present an opportunity for new revenue streams of charging or swapping. When the energy supply shift to renewables, EVs will become cleaner. There is no point in debating whether EVs are cleaner today. It will be cleaner and cleaner when the days go by. And EVs can play a vital role as a storage of energy for all of you, or the grid, to stabilize or to use them in a critical way for us. Thank you.